Once upon a time, a British restaurant meant a place owned by two queens with an extravagant colour sense, an interesting poodle, and a load of recipes received at third hand from Elizabeth David, the secular saint of the gastronomic revolution. The two queens did it out of love. They were amateurs in the original and best sense. Amateurism is routinely considered to be inimical to professionalism. One wonders, would modern restaurants be more hospitable, more inviting, were amateurism to be welded to professionalism? Were staff enjoined to demonstrate a fondness for their work rather than mere slickness? It's a question of both and rather than either or. But maybe it's too much to hope for in a world in which restaurants have, for the first time in Britain, become businesses rather than paying hobbies. No food in the Britain of new food is ever bought, nor is it ever found. It is sourced. I might source some cheese from here, or I might source some olive oil here. And if I source the olive oil, I won't pour it. I shall drizzle it. It is mandatory to drizzle olive oil. And should I use that or another oil for cooking, it will be for pan frying, an expression which presumably differentiates that method of boiling an oil from coat hanger frying. These usages are ugly, precious, twee. They suggest that real food belongs to a hermetic caste with an exclusive vocabulary. Unhappily, they suggest correctly.
Formidable, mais quelle beauté troublante.
Tripe, flaky. Tripe, chaos, tripe. Only in English does the word for a cow's stomach signify worthlessness and rubbish.
Yeah.
Udder, which used occasionally to be sold in this country under the name of elder, is nature's answer to spam. If you like spam, you'll love udder.
Vegetarians. Vegetarianism is truly as the new English disease. Like the old English disease, flagellation, it speaks of hatred of the body. It's a form of internal corporal punishing. It is saying there can be no pleasure without pain. Any day, give me a good whipping and beef with burgundy, huh?
This is where Elizabeth David composed the first chapters of a book of Mediterranean food. If there has been a gastronomic revolution, this then might be said to be the place where it started. I've sourced the beginning. But one might be forgiven for wondering, has it actually spread any further? Whenever any newspaper or magazine wishes to demonstrate the actuality of this great revolution, it invariably dispatches someone down here, not to Ross-on-Wye, but to the neighbouring town of Ludlow.
Il y en a qui disent que les Français vivent d'amour et de vin frais, et que toutes les filles d'ici habitent au casino de Paris-Jouet. Y'en a qui pensent que le champagne sort des gargouilles de notre...
Ludlow's population is a mere 9,000. Yet it has three gastronomic restaurants, an astonishing number in this country.
It has a market which sells cheese which isn't plastic wrapped in more plastic. It has five independent butchers, including the excellent Reg Martins, whose pork scratchings are every bit as fine as the gratin in a Lyonnais bouchon.
Indeed, Ludlow is rather French in feel. It's bourgeoisie, the people with the money to support posh restaurants and shops, live in the town rather than in the surrounding villages, which is the English norm. Its people take pleasure in the predominantly local produce.
The reason why it's always cited as proof of the glorious revolution is that there's nowhere else in Britain like it. Ludlow is the exception that proves the rule of provincial Britain's gastronomic backwardness.
You better come on in my kitchen.
The blues were born out of desperation, discrimination and indigence in a particular place at a particular time. They were regarded in this country as dangerously primitive. I've taken every nigger from her. Nonetheless, suburban Britons who had suffered little more hardship than post-war rationing adopted them. Every small town in this country boasted its own Robert Johnson, its own Leadbelly. When the time's coming, our adoption of foreign modes of cooking is entirely analogous. We cook as we sing in a phony foreign accent. We cook as imitators of mere mannerisms, with no sense of the causes of the cooking. It's gonna be raining outdoors.
It's hot. Lovely. And? And what?
Where's it from?
I come to the shop, of course.
It's your ham, and it's from... I'll give you a clue. It's a bird.
A bird? Well, I've eaten a cockatoo in my time, but none of them tastes like this.
Really, you surprised me. It's an Aylesbury duckling, and it's from...
York ham, Yorkshire pudding, Aylesbury duckling, cheddar cheese, Wiltshire bacon, Eccles cake, Dundee cake, Lincolnshire chine, Cumberland sausages. All British food with a place name attached actually comes from an industrial estate in Kettering. There's no such thing as a protected name in this country, which is a sign of the importance that we attach to the integrity of foodstuffs.
Last time I hit one of these, I scraped the fellow off the road and popped him in the boot, or trunk as you Americans would have it. I took him home and marinated him in some white wine, vinegar, a bit of garlic, and then I sautéed it.
What did it taste like?
What did it taste like? Bit like dog. Toodle-pip.
Do you agree that we are what we eat? If that's the case, then what are you? Chat to Jonathan Meades right now. He's logged into BBC iFood for a live chat at bbc.co.uk/food.
animals were eaten in the making of this film.